Hey guys, we are going to start with a data visualization project using Python. Specifically, we are going to cover chapter 15 of the book Python Crash Course. We'll learn about two different Python libraries, Matplotlib and Plotly, which we are going to use to generate plots and graphs. We'll start by generating a simple plot, but then we are going to continue with a random walk and also simulating dice. If you want to follow along, you'll find the link to the book in the description down below. Feel free to subscribe to the channel and let's get right into it. In our second major project, we are going to focus on data visualization. And data visualization involves exploring data through visual representation. It is closely associated with data analysis, which is focusing more on coding and exploring patterns and connections in datasets. And since Python is quite efficient, we don't need a supercomputer to analyze large datasets, but we can do that from a laptop, analyzing, for example, a dataset with millions of data points. And also the data points that we analyze don't have to be numbers. We can actually also analyze non-numerical data as well. Now, aside from programming itself, Python is used for a lot of data-intensive work in various fields, for example, in genetics, in political and economic analysis, in climate research, and many other fields. And therefore, data scientists have written an impressive number of different libraries that we can use in Python, two of which we are going to work with today. So the first one is called Matplotlib, which is a mathematical plotting library. And we can create simple plots using Matplotlib, for example, line graphs and scatter plots, but we can also work with more interesting data sets. For example, visualizing a random walk, so a visualization generated from a series of random decisions. And we are also going to use a second Python package called Plotly, which creates visualization that work well on digital devices and automatically resize depending on the device size. So let's get into that and let's start out by installing Matplotlib. So initially, of course, we should create a separate folder for our second project. I call it data visualization, and then we need to enter this command. So we are going to use pip as a package manager to install Matplotlib. I already did that before, but if you haven't installed yet, it will download the requirements and basically install the library. Now, once installed, we can create a new file and plot a simple line graph. So here we imported pyplot from Matplotlib from that module, and we also gave it an alias of plt, so we save a little bit of time typing and can very quickly issue the commands we want to work with. We then have a list with five different entries called squares, which holds the data that we want to plot. And then we follow a common Matplotlib convention by calling the subplots function over here. And this function can generate one or more plots in the same figure. So we have two variables here, fig and x, and fig represents the entire figure or collection of plots that are generated, while the variable x or ax represents a single plot in the figure and is a variable we'll use most of the time. And then we use a plot message which we call on x and we pass the list to it. And finally, of course, we also want to display the graph, and therefore we are going to call show on plt. So let's execute our program, and of course we do that in the same way as before. We type Python followed by the name of the Python script we want to execute. And once we do that, that figure is going to be created. We can see our graph that was created by Matplotlib. We have the option to zoom in and out on certain sections, and we can also save this graph as a PNG file, for instance. So if we want to share it with somebody else, we could do that. Now, even though our plot shows that the numbers are increasing, the labels were kind of a little bit too small, and also it was not really clear what was actually displayed. But fortunately, Matplotlib allows us to really adjust all the different aspects of our plots that we are displaying. So therefore, we can head over to our Python script here and we can make some adjustments. So for instance, we can increase the line width so that it is displayed a little bit bigger. We can also, for example, set a title for our plot, and we can also adjust the font size for the different values. So here, for example, we set an X label and a Y label that's going to be displayed. And we are also increasing the label size for the tick labels. So let's take a look at what this looks like. And now we can see that the line is a lot thicker. We have now a heading that's displayed, and we have the different labels that are showing up. But taking a closer look at that, we can see that the data is actually not correct. We want to display the square numbers here, but if we, for instance, take a look at the number 4 here, It actually shows a square number of 25, which is incorrect. And the reason for that is that when we give plot a sequence of numbers, it assumes that the first data point corresponds to an x-axis value of 0, but in our case, it corresponds to a value of 1. We can override this default, however, by specifying some input values that should be used, and then we can pass the input values as an additional argument to our plot. So with these updates, let's close down our figure and let's generate a new chart. And now we can see that it is displayed correctly. So for the number 5, we have the squared number 25. For 4, it should be 16. So that looks a lot better. Matplotlib has a number of predefined styles available. For example, we can set the background, colors, grid lines, line widths, and a lot more. And in order to see which styles are available on our system, we can head over to a terminal. And inside of our Python shell, we can then import matplotlib. And once we've done that, we can then take a look at the different styles available. And we can see there are a number of different options we can choose from. So to use any of these styles available, we can simply add one line of code before starting to generate our plot. So if we go back to our file here, we can simply decide to add a style, for example, seaborne, which is one of the available options. And then once we have selected that, we can of course run our program again. And now we can see the applied style here, so seaborne in our case. On the matplotlib website, we can see a number of different chart types that are available that we can choose from. And if we want to see any details, we can simply click on that option. And then we can also see what the code is that's required to display this option. So if we want to plot a single point, we would use the scatter method. And to plot a single point, we would use the scatter method. We can simply pass the single xy value to a point of interest to scatter, and this is going to plot the values. So if we take a look at an example, here we are using again the same style as before, so seaborne, and we are going to create a subplot, and this time we are going to use the scatter method here, and we pass the x and y coordinate to it, and now we should see a single point. Let's run this code. Let's take a look at this graph. And here we can see indeed we plotted a single point that is displayed here in this scatter chart using the seaborne layout. Let's style the output to make it more interesting. So we're going to add a title, label the axis, and also make sure that all the text is large enough to read. So to do that, we are going to pass an additional argument to scatter, this parameter s, which we are going to set to 200, and that determines the size of the dots which are drawn on the graph. We're also setting the title, the labels, just as before, and also the tick params. So now when we call our Python file again, we should see the updated graph here, and we can see the point here is a lot larger. We have a title and also correct labels being displayed on the x and y axis. We can pass scatter separate lists of x and y values. So for instance, we have two separate lists here, one with x values and then one with y values. And now we can take a look at scatter, and we pass, instead of passing individual points to it, we pass the lists to it. And also we decreased the size a little bit so it's displayed properly. And now if we run our file again, we can see that we display the x and y values, and matplotlib reads one value from each list as it plots each point. So for example, we have here the point 1, 1, and then we have the point 2, 4, 0.39, 416, and 525, so exactly the x value and the y value in the separate lists. So let's take a look at how we can calculate data automatically by using a loop to calculate values. So here we have an example where we first of all define a range of values for our x values. Here we have the values from 1 through 1000, and then we are using list comprehension to calculate the squares for those numbers. So here we are looping over all the entries in our x values list up here, and then we are squaring it and saving that back in a list. We can pass those x and y values to our scatter plot. We also decrease the size of the dots because we have a lot more values, and we are defining the range for the axes, so we cover a larger range for that. So let's take a look at what this looks like by executing our Python script again. And now if we take a look at that, we have a smooth transition of the numbers here, so we have 1000 values that are being displayed. We can also change the color of the points, and all we need to do for that is to supply an additional argument to our scatter function. So here we are going to add C, for example red, and once we save this and we execute our file again, we now see that our graph here, or the different dots, are displayed in red. We can also define custom colors using the RGB color model. So to define those colors, instead of supplying a name of a color, we can simply add the numbers of red, green, and blue, and those should be supplied as values between 0 and 1. So let's, for example, say we are going to supply a value of 0% red, 80% green, and 0% red, like this. Now once we save that and we execute our file again, we get a green graph because we supplied those values. It's also possible to use a color map. A color map is a series of colors in a gradient that moves from a starting to an ending color. So basically we have a smooth transition, and that can be quite useful if you want to emphasize, for example, a change in a value and associate that with a darker color, for example. And the pyplot module that we are using actually includes a set of built-in color maps that we can use. One example is the following. So we can go ahead and instead of providing C a direct value here, we instead say we want to apply that to our Y values that we are using. And then we can add our color map as an additional argument. And here we are going to say we are going to use different colors of blue. So we can add that as a value. And now if we go ahead and we generate our scatter plot one more time, we can see now we have a smooth transition here from a light blue color over to a dark blue color. And of course that's available for other colors as well. So if we wanted to, we could change that from blue value to red values, for example, and then generate our plot one more time. And now we can see we have a transition for red colors. Let's take a look at the exercises. So we have two separate exercises. The first one is to work with cubes instead of squares. So we should first plot the first 5 cubic numbers and then plot the first 5,000 cubic numbers. So for the first 5 cubic numbers, we can actually go ahead and just define the input values and the output values. And we are going to create a simple line graph with those values. So again, we are defining the style we want to use, so seaborn in this case. We are defining our subplots here. And then also we set the chart title, of course, to cube numbers and cube of value. And then finally we show our plot here. So let's take a look at that. And when we open that, we can see we have this kind of graph here. So we always have the cube of the value displayed and this shown as a line graph. Now when you have a large number of values, for example 5,000, then of course that won't be possible anymore. So in that case we are going to use a scatter plot, and specifically we are going to display the values from 1 to 5,000. So again we are using the range operation here for the x value to define a range from 1 to 5,000, and then we are using list comprehension to generate the cube by iterating over each value inside of this generated list. We are also getting a little bit ahead, applying a color map to our cube plot by, in this case, using different colors of red. So let's take a look at that. And here we can see we are generating our values. Here on the x-axis, we have the values from 0 all the way up to 5,000. And then on the y-axis, the values actually get extremely large, and therefore we have this scientific notation. But these are basically the y values corresponding to the third cube of the values displayed here. Let's next use Python to generate data for a random walk and to represent that visually using matplotlib. So a random walk is a path that has no clear direction but is determined by a series of random decisions, each of which is left entirely to chance. Random walks have a lot of practical applications, for example in nature, in physics, biology, chemistry and economics. So for example, the molecular motion of water is one example of a random walk. And we are going to start out by creating a random walk class, and then we are going to use matplotlib to actually visualize the data. So let's take a look at that. Let's create a new Python file that we are going to call random walk. This is going to be a class, random walk, and we first of all going to import the choice method from the random module. So our class randomWalk is a class to generate random walks. Inside of the init method, we are going to specify an default argument of num points. So if we don't provide an argument, 5000 points are going to be generated. And then we are going to define the points of an x value and a y value for our chart. And now we are going to have a method inside of it. So it's going to be called fillWalk. And here we are going to calculate the different points of the walk. We have a while loop here that iterates over the number of points that we have defined up here, so 5000 by default. And then we are deciding on the x direction, the distance, and the step that we are taking. So basically all of that is random, so we select a direction either to the right with a positive value or to the left with a negative value, and then we determine the distance, so all the way up from 0 to 4, and then we are multiplying both values with each other. So basically we have the distance here and also the x direction to the left or to the right. We do the same for the y direction and the y distance, and then we reject moves that would go nowhere. So if we have a step of x and y that's both 0, then we are just going to skip. Otherwise we're going to add that to our x values here, and of course the number of x and y values here is going to increase, and once they reach the desired value, so 5000 for example, we are of course going to stop our loop. And at the very end we are going to append the new value x and y to our x values and the y values here. So this is the method that we define. In order to use it, we're going to create a separate Python module to visualize it. And here, of course, we are going to import matplotlib pyplot as before. And we are also going to import the class we just wrote. We are going to initialize an object of our class, randomWalk. And then we call fillWalk, which of course is the method we wrote before. And we are going to display that in a scatter plot, referencing the x values and the y values. So let's take a look at that, and let's run our RW visuals Python script here. And here we can see what we get back. So these are 5000 points that are provided, and we can see basically a random distribution of the different points that are displayed, and that can be very useful to simulate random data. So every random walk that we generate is different, and it can be quite fun to explore the different options that we can get. So one way we can quickly generate multiple different random walks is to use a while loop, as we're doing right here. So we wrap the entire statement inside of a while loop, and then we are saying, while this is true, we are going to generate a new random walk object and call fillWalk just as before. And then at the end of it, we are going to ask the user if they want to generate another walk. And if they type anything else other than n, we're going to generate a new scatter plot showing another random walk. So let's take a look at that in practice, and let's run our program here. And of course we are going to generate a new random walk like this, and we can take a look at that. And once we are happy with it, or we want to see a different plot, we can just close it down. And then we are going to get asked if we want to generate another walk. I'm going to type y, and that's going to create a new random walk, and this way we can take a look at the different walks that we generate, and we can work with the random data that is being generated. And of course we can stop execution by typing n, and that's going to end our while loop. We can also customize our plot, for example to emphasize the important characteristic of each walk and de-emphasize unimportant elements. We can for example emphasize where the walk began, where it ended, the path taken, and we can also highlight different tick marks and labels. So let's start out by coloring the different points, and we are using a color map to show the order of the points on the walk. And then we are going to remove the black outline so we can actually see a clear gradient of where our walk started and where it ended. So we just need to do a minor adjustment to our code to accomplish that. First of all, we are going to generate a range here for our different points, so by default the 5000 points, which are going to be stored inside of point numbers. And then we need to make a small adjustment to our scatter call here, our scatter method. So first of all, we are going to use the C argument for our color, and we are referencing the point numbers here for our gradient. And then of course we are going to use our color map In this case, we are going to use shades of blue, so from very light blue to dark blue. And then we also remove the edge colors so that we have a nice transition. Let's take another look at what our random walk now looks like. We can now see the starting point of our random walk is displayed very light, and then we can see where our walk actually leads us to. So we end down here. Let's take a look at another example. We can take advantage of the loop we wrote, and here we can see another example. So it's very clear where we started out and where we ended up at the end. And here another example. So in this point we have a zero here, we start over here, then we go a little bit in the positive direction, and then we move over to the left side, the negative coordinates, and we end up here at minus 300 roughly. So in addition to coloring the points to show the position along the walk, it may be helpful to highlight the starting point and the ending points, so we can see right away where our random walk started and where it ended. So to accomplish that, we'll make the endpoints larger and color them in different colors so it's visible right away where our walk started and finished. And to do that, we are going to plot the starting point at 0,0 in the color green. And we are going to plot the endpoint, which is of course the last value in our x values and y values lists, as being red. So let's take a look at that. Let's run our program again. And now we can see the green point here highlights the starting point at 0,0. We can see the walk here. And then the red point is the point of the last entry, so that's the end of our random walk. Sometimes it can be useful to remove the axes of our plot so we can focus on the actual values in there. And to do that, all we need to do is to call getAxes on AX here and then change the value of setVisible to false. Let's take a look at our plot one more time. And now we can see we still have our starting point and our endpoint, but the x-axis and the y-axis have been removed. Let's increase the number of points to give us more data to work with. To do that, we can simply add an argument to randomWalk. So instead of using the default value of 5,000, we can increase this, for example, to 50,000, which is a lot closer to a real-world scenario. Let's also make sure that we decrease the size of each point so everything fits on the screen. Now with these changes, let's actually run our program again. So now we can see that we have a lot more data points and it looks a little bit more cloudy. So this is closer to what real-world data would actually look like. But so far we always had to resize the screen to display this properly. Instead of doing it manually, we can adjust our code. And in here we can say that instead of just using the subplot here, we can actually pass some values to it. We are going to use the fix size attribute. And here we can, for example, pass in a tuple with the values 15 and 9. And now we can see our screen is automatically resized and a little bit bigger. And if it's not properly displayed on your screen, you can just adjust those figures a little bit. We can provide an additional attribute passing the resolution to it. So to do that, let's just adjust those values a little bit to 10 and 6, for example. And then let's pass a second argument called DPI. And let's set that to 128. And that should automatically update the resolution. So let's take a look at that, and we can see it's displayed properly and it is on the right size. Let's continue with the exercises. And the first one is called molecular motion. So we should modify our RW visual Python file, the randomWalk file, by replacing axScatter with the plot method. And we do that to simulate the path of a pollen grain on the surface of a drop of water. And instead of using a value of 50,000, we should use a value of 5,000. So let's do that. Let's head over to our code editor and we can simply create a new file and basically copy over the information we specified in the other file before. But here we are now passing in a value of 5,000, or we could also just remove this to go with the default value. And then instead of going with the scatter plot, we are just passing plot in here. We pass the x values and also the y values, and then we specify a line width. So let's take a look at that and let's run that code. And we are getting this kind of graph. So instead of having a scatter plot, we actually have lines in here. So this is what it looks like. In the next exercise, modified random walks, we should actually make some adjustments. Specifically, we should play around with the direction that is chosen, and also with the distance. So we should modify these values to see what happens overall to our graph that's being generated. So let's head over to our file, and over here in random walk we can make those adjustments. So let's for example increase the x distance here, and let's add values for 5, 6, 7, and 8. We can save this, and then let's also say that we save this for now and we just execute this file. So if we take a look at that, because we added those x ranges, now we basically can have a wider x range, a wider width that can be displayed, because of course we multiply this distance here with the direction. So now instead of getting a maximum value of 4, we can get a maximum value of 8. So therefore generally we have like wider distances here between those points, and our entire graph is a little bit more spread out. Let's see what happens if we make some other adjustments. So let's say for example we are going to remove the negative value here for our x direction. Let's save that and let's run our program again. And now we can basically only go in the positive direction on the x-axis. That means we can't move back to the left in this graph, but only to the right. And therefore we get this kind of like, it almost looks like a stock market graph that's being displayed, because the only real variation that we have is in the y-axis. So here we go up and down. And of course we could do the same with the y value. So let's just add -1 back here. And let's say we can maybe only go in the negative direction for the y value. So let's take a look at that. Let's just close this down. And let's run our program one more time. And now we can see we have a similar effect, but now in the kind of opposite direction. So here we have our y value. It always goes down, never back up. And therefore we have a more linear kind of display. Now let's finally say that we make some adjustments to both of those. So we can maybe just say -1 for both the y direction and the x direction. Let's run our program one more time. And now we have basically a straight line here that's being displayed. And since we have a -1 value provided, we start out from the top right side and we go in the negative x direction and in the negative y direction. And it's pretty much a straight line. So that means it's really the direction here with the values that can be provided that makes it a little bit more complex, let's say. So let's add that back though to the values of 0 to 4. And let's take a look at the last exercise. The last exercise here covers refactoring. So we should take the fill walk method and we should create a new method called getStep to determine the direction and distance for each step. And then we should calculate the step. So at the end, we should basically end up with those calls. So we have xStep and we call simply getStep on self, and thereby we get those steps. And this refactoring here should really reduce the size of fill walk and make the method easier to read and understand. So let's take a look at that. So inside of random walk, we have our fill walk method, and basically all of this code here can be shortened by quite a bit. To do that, we can create a new method, getStep. Whatever we have in here can basically be replaced by getStep. We also see we have quite a bit of repetition here between the x values and the y values. So instead of doing all of that, we can go ahead and we can basically say we want to remove that. Instead, we just want to say we want to set the value for xStep. And for that, we're going to call getStep on self. And we're basically going to do the same for our y step. And since basically the action here is the same for the x and y value, we can simply use the same function for both. Of course, if we wanted some variation between x step and y step, we would need to make some adjustments. So let's save that and let's see if our code still works properly. And it looks like it's pretty much the same as before. So we still have this kind of random walk displayed properly. After using matplotlib, let's take a look at another Python package we can use, Plotly, which can be used to produce interactive visualizations. Plotly is particularly useful when we are creating visualizations that will be placed in a browser, because the visualizations can scale automatically to fit the viewer's screen. And Plotly generates also visualizations that are interactive, so when the user, for example, hovers over certain elements on the screen, information about that element will be highlighted. So To get started using Plotly, let's install it first of all. Again, we are using pip as a package manager and entering this command python-m pip install --user plotly. We can install Plotly as a tool. And once we install Plotly, we can take a quick look at their website, and here are some examples of the types of visualizations we can achieve with Plotly. So we can take a look at that website here. If you, for example, click on this chart here, we can see the source code required to create such a graph. And if we click on any of those bars, for example, this bar chart, we can see the respective figure is displayed automatically. So we are going to use Plotly to visualize data associated with rolling dice. In particular, we are going to roll a number of different dice and then evaluate the results to see which kind of side is rolled most often. To do that, let's start out by creating a die class. We are creating a new module called die.py, and in here we have a class die. We import randint from the random module, and then we are going to initialize the die class. We are assuming that by default a die has 6 sides. Of course, we could provide a different value, but that's the default value here. And then we have another method in here called roll, and that's going to return a random value between 1 and the number of sides. And this is including the side provided here. Before actually starting to visualize the data when rolling a die, let's first of all just write some code to actually display a die roll. So here we have a separate Python file that we created, die visual. We import, of course, our class die from our die module, and then we create a die with 6 sides, so d6 abbreviated, and we are rolling 100 times. We're getting the result of rolling this by calling the roll method that we defined inside of our die class, and then we append whatever we rolled to a list called results. And that's going to be printed out. Let's take a look at that and let's run that code with different values ranging all the way from 1 up to 6. And so these are 100 randomly generated values. Now let's update our code a little bit so that we display not the individual die rolls, but instead the number of times a certain side is rolled. For example, that the first side 1 is rolled, let's say, 100 times. And to do that, we can first of all increase the range that we display. So instead of displaying 100 die rolls, we are going to increase that to 1000, because we are no longer going to display the individual results of rolling a die. And then we are adding a new empty list called frequencies, and then we are going to loop over the different sides, so 1 to 6. And of course the upper bound is exclusive, that's why we have to add 1 up here. And then we are counting the results of that value, so how often, for example, the number 1 appeared, and we are going to add that to frequency. And finally, we're going to add frequency to our frequencies list, and we're going to print that out. By the end, we're going to have the numbers of how often the 1 side, 2 side, 3 side, and so on and so forth have been rolled. Let's run our code again. Now we can see that's about equally distributed here between the different sides. With the list of frequencies that we created, we can make a histogram of the results. So a histogram is a bar chart showing how often certain results occur. So let's update our die visual file. We're firstly going to import the bar class and the layout class from Plotly graph objects, and then we're also going to import the offline capability of the Plotly module. Now, in order to visualize the results, we are going to create a range from 1 to the number of sides, and we need to turn that into a list to operate that, because Plotly accepts values as a list. We are then going to define a data object here. Specifically, we want to use the bar chart capability, and we pass the x and the y values to it. So the x value is going to be the list of sides of the die, and then y is going to be the frequency, how often each result occurs. We are also going to specify the title on the x-axis, so the results, and then the frequency of the results on the y-axis. Finally, we are going to add a title, so we are showing the results of rolling 1d6 die 1000 times. And finally, we are going to call plot on offline, which is going to display our result. And we are going to specify a file name, so here d6, and it's an HTML file that we're working with. So let's take a look at that and let's run our code. And as we execute our file, a new browser window will open, and we can see the results here displayed as a histogram. So here we can see the number of results. and we can see it's about equally distributed. Of course, if we increase the number of times we roll our die, then the results will be more equal here, but we can see it's about evenly spread. And Plotly also made our charge interactive, so if we hover over it, we can always see the values, so the x and the y value. In this case, we have, for example, the side 2 of our die, and it has been rolled 177 times, which is the frequency we pass to it, so we can get a quick overview just by hovering over the respective bar. Now, if instead we are rolling two dice, that's going to result in a larger number, of course, and we are going to have a different distribution. So let's model that. If we go back to our text editor here, we can create a separate dice visual file, which displays the results of rolling two d6 dice. So in this case here, we need to instantiate, of course, two separate dice that we are going to use. And then our result is going to be the sum of rolling the first die and the second die. That, of course, also leads to the fact that we have a number of maximum results. So specifically, our maximum result is now the number of sides on the first die and the number of sides on the second die. So if we have two regular d6 dice, as we have in this case, we are going to have a maximum result number of 12 and a minimum result number of 2, because of course each die could have a value of 1, that's the lowest value allowed, and so we have the range from 2 to 12, which we are including here in our loop. And again, we are specifying the frequencies using the count method here, and then we are appending that to our frequencies list. We are also going to update our x-axis configuration. Specifically, we are going to add the dtick attribute here and set that to 1. Otherwise, Plotly is going to remove the labels for some of the bars. Once we reach a certain number of bars, we want to display all of them, so that's why we update that. And of course, we need to specify a new file name. So let's run this updated file with our two dice. And let's take a look at the results. And once that's generated and loaded, we can see it's no longer about equally distributed as was the case before, but instead it's more widely spread out. We can see one result is most likely here, rolling a 7. And then, for example, rolling a 2 or a total of 12 is much less likely. And that happens because there are way more options to roll a total of 7 compared to roll a total of 2 or 12. In fact, there's only one way to roll a 12 or a 2. That means if both die have a value of 1, for example, or have a value of 6, we are going to get to those extreme results. But there are many ways to roll a total of 7. So, for example, we could roll a 1 and a 6, a 2 and a 5, a 3 and a 4, a 4 and a 3, 5 and a 2, or 6 and a 1. So for this, to analyze that, Plotly is really helpful. Now let's actually roll two die with different sizes. So we are going to roll a 6-sided die as before, but then also a 10-sided die. And let's create a separate program for that. So here we are going to specify that we again instantiate two separate objects, but this time we're going to have a regular die, which defaults to a value of 6, and then we're going to have a second die with 10 sides. Now this time we're going to roll it with a larger number. We are passing a value of 50,000 to it. Again, the maximum result here is going to be the sum of the different sides, and we are going to update our title here as well as the file name. So let's take a look at that, and let's run this. And now if you take a look at this result, it's quite a bit different from the previous one. So here we have a total of 16 possible values, and we have actually 5 values that are quite likely. So it's about equally likely to roll a 7, 8, 9, 10, or 11. If we compare that to our 2d6 dice, then we can see there was a single value that's most likely. Here we have 5. And that's because there's only one way again to roll the smallest number or the largest number. But there are 6 ways to roll a 7, 8, 9, 10, or 11. So that's why we have 5 values that have about the same likelihood of being rolled. Let's take a look at the exercises. The first exercise here asks us to create a simulation showing what will happen when we roll 2 8-sided dice 1,000 times. And then we should gradually increase the number of rolls until we start to see the limits of our system's capacity. So let's head over to our code editor. And here we are creating 2 D8 die that are created here, and we are going to roll it. Let's say we are going to start with let's say 10,000 times. And again, we are summing the number of sites to get the max results and basically update it accordingly. So let's execute this program. Let's see the results. And here we can see that 9 is the result that occurs most frequently. And again, we have 2 and 16, so the minimum and maximum value occurring the least often. There are a lot more combinations that can lead to a total of 9 compared to only one option leading to a total of 2 and one option leading to an option of 16. Now let's increase the number of roles that we perform, and let's update that from 10,000 to 1 million. Let's run our program again. That may take a little longer to execute, but we should get a more precise result. And here we can see, if we compare that to the previous one, we can see that we have a much more equal outcome here. So 9 is rolled most often, and 2 and 16 have the same likelihood of being rolled, and 15 and 3, and so on and so forth. The second exercise here asks us to roll 3 dice. So when we roll 3 d6 dice, the smallest number we can roll is a 3, and the largest number is 18. So we should create a visualization that shows what happens when we roll 3 d6 dice. So let's head over, and of course we are going to instantiate 3 different die here that we are going to roll. We're going to roll that a certain number of time, and then we need to make sure that we actually roll from a minimum of 3 to the max results, which again is the sum of those 3 different die that we are going to use. And then also we have a range here from 3 all the way up to the max result plus 1. So with that being updated, let's head over and let's run our program. And here we can see the results. So having a total of 10 or 11, that's the most likely outcome. So that will be rolled most often, followed by 9 and 12 and so on and so forth. And rolling a 3 or an 18, that's of course the least likely one, because here all dice would have to have the maximum value of 6 or the minimum value of 1. So far we have been adding the values for rolling the dice, which is a logical outcome, but the next exercise asks us to multiply those results. So here we should create a visualization that shows what happens if we multiply the numbers of 2 dice being rolled. So let's look at that, and in this case again we have 2 separate dice. So let's say for example that's a default d6 die, and then instead of adding those values we are going to multiply them. And that of course will mean that we have a maximum value of 36 if we have 2 regular die, and a minimum value of 1 if you multiply 1 with 1. And we can already tell that certain numbers are not going to appear between 1 and 36, because there's no way to multiply 2 values and get to a certain one. So let's take a look at what this looks like if we run our code. So here we can see the outcome, and we can see some scenarios are most likely and some are less likely and some can't occur. So for example here, rolling a 13 would not be possible because there are no 2 integer numbers between 1 and 6 that can get multiplied to get to a 13. And the same is true for other values like 14 or 17. But we can see some values are more likely and some are less likely. So for example, if you take a look at a 4, that's more likely than for example a 9, because for 4 we could of course roll a 4 and a 1 for example, or 1 and a 4. But if both die have a 2 for example, that would also lead to a 4. And in the case of a 9, that's of course less likely. So if you roll a 3 and a 3, that should be the only way to get there. So that's why the 9 is less likely. Let's take a look at the next exercise, and here we should update the for loop that we have been using, and instead of using a for loop we should be using list comprehension. So let's take a look at that. So far we have been using for loops up here for rolling the different dice, and also here for taking a look at the generating the frequencies. And of course we can rewrite that using list comprehension. So instead of the for loop we can do the following. If we take the example of the 3 different die that we have been rolling, here we can just move the addition of those 3 different die rolls into a list, and then also the statement for the roll number in the range. So we are adding this in here, and we can do the same for the frequencies. So here we were counting the values in results, and we are doing that for all the values in the range from 2 to the maximum result plus 1. Let's just check that this is still working properly. And here we can see we still get sort of the same outcome as before when we use the for loop. So this is basically an alternative option that we could take, and it can be a little bit more concise. We learned how to generate datasets and visualize that data using Python. We learned about Matplotlib and how we can use it to generate simple plots and scatter plots. We also use Plotly to display histograms. If you have any questions, feel free to add them to the comment section down below. In the next video, we are going to download data from online sources and use Matplotlib and Plotly to explore that data. See you guys in the next video.